The White Wonder, my friend, your friend, Whitey Julius Pinty, whatever you wanted to call him, he came. Good to see some old faces, figuratively and literally. Whitey might have added to that with that peculiar way he had of enunciating his consonants. I'm going to read this just like Whitey. Yes, but it is probably more important at our age just to be seen. Do you not concur, Squire? Anyway, so back in the mid-60s, early mid-60s, Whitey had 2 years on me, which when you're young and starting out in this business, that's huge. And already with the roulettes, he was becoming a bit of a local legend. And a little later on, when he got to the Blue Note and Dominic showed up there one night, and the two of them ended up getting together and becoming the Rogues. That symbiotic relationship over the next 7 years created some really interesting music. The two of them pushed each other like you wouldn't believe, and their talents just grew to the max. Whitey, as anybody that's ever seen him play or been with him in a band, this guy was mesmerizing to watch and listen to. He was something else. Very, very unique and very, very short order. He went from listening to his influences like the Buddy Riches, the Joe Morales, the Philly Joe Joneses, and very, very rapidly became a major influencer himself. A lot of guys would just sit there with their mouths open watching him play, going, God, I wanted to do that, but how can I do that? He was truly, truly amazing. He had this unique ability of whatever genre he was playing, it sounded like that was what he grew up on. It didn't matter what it was, whether it was jazz, funk, Latin, he made that sound like his own. And I do not know anybody that ever sat in with him in a jam session or played with him in a band that does not cherish and remember John, that experience with great fondness. There is no way. Lucky me, I got to replace George and Mandela, and that's when I got to find more of a personal aspect to Whitey that I wasn't really that aware of before. The jump around aspect of that band, I like to refer to it as, was not something that came easy to me. You know, the splits, the cartwheels, the backdrops, the knee drops, the throwing the mic around, did not come easy to me. And I found out that Whitey, back in high school, was a champion gymnast, which pretty well explained his dexterity on the kit too. But that meant he became my de facto gymnast coach, dance move teacher, and every now and then when he lost a little patience with me, I would hear something to the effect of his favorite expletive, Godfrey Daniel, is this going to take much longer, sir? And sometimes it did. But he never lost patience with me, and I loved him to death for that. And he kept my injuries down to a dull war, too. So, a few quick Whitey stories. I asked Karen about this, and all the time she'd been with him, she had heard about this, but had never seen him actually do it. And back in the day when we'd take breaks from rehearsal, by the way, Whitey and Cars, kind of like myself, did not really get along too well. And the first accident that he was in knocked out his two front teeth. So they sat on a plate, you see. And I remember being one of the early rehearsals with the band, and Donnie Elliott said to me, have you ever seen Whitey do the rodent?
Oh, no.
Anybody ever seen him do this in this room? John has, I'm sure. I'm going to try and describe this to you because you had to see this to believe it, because then you started peeing your pants laughing for half an hour. What he would do, hands on the floor, take his legs, put them over his shoulders, This was after he had mussed up his hair like this, spucked the two front teeth out, and then did side steps on his hand, and at the end of which, he would kick his foot. You get it? So the hands were the feet, and the feet were the hands. This was stunning to watch, and he did it every now and then. I still can't believe to this day, he at least didn't do this in the bedroom once with Karen. Would have been something. He also had an interesting game, both in rehearsal and in hotel rooms, it didn't matter where we were, called Keep Away. You could not, I don't care how fast you thought you were, you could not catch this guy. Didn't matter whether it was a small room or a big room, and he hardly moved. It was almost like Muhammad Ali in his prime where everything just missed. That's why he would move very little bit in any direction, and you would be furiously trying to touch him, and you never could. And you'd watch him gallop around the room, and it was some sort of combination of a flying Melinda, Groucho Marx, and then the insane cackling laugh to go along with it. Hysterical stuff. As a soloist, I always said, somebody once said to me, well, how would you classify his drumming? What would you describe it as? I always say that I always thought of Whitey as a musical drummer. He wasn't just a percussionist. He wasn't just a percussionist. He played the drums like a musical instrument. If you got a chance to see him solo, which was entertaining both from a hysterically funny standpoint and from a technical standpoint, he would play all the instruments after he played his drums with his sticks. Or the monitors, or whatever, and you never knew what from one night to the next what he was going to do with that. He had a unique way of bending his cymbals and sort of humming nursery rhymes along with them and actually hitting the notes. It was not just playing the drums; it was playing a musical instrument that you could hit. It was absolutely amazing to watch. Let's get back to the music because that's what this is all about. So, I keep saying he was awesome. We all know that. For 50 plus years, I knew this guy. And if you go through the early wars together, a bond is there that can never be broken. I mean, time and distance always gets in the way, but Whitey was definitely one of those guys where it didn't matter how much time, if you talked to him, it was like no time had passed at all. And all the conversations always ended up with, love you. That's just the way Whitey was. So, are there things that Whitey maybe said and did that he possibly regretted? Sure. Don't we all? Are there some things that perhaps we would find exasperating about Whitey? Sure, but aren't we all in some ways exasperated? I think if anything, as friends, we worried about Whitey more than anything else. And at this point, I'd like to say to Karen, thanks so much for you looking after him all those years, because this day could have considerably have come a little sooner if it wasn't for you. Sean and I were talking about this the other day. Whitey was always a dreamer from as far back as we can remember. Along with his legendary capacity to imbibe in the odd beverage or two, along with that came a rather vivid imagination that sometimes resulted in Walter Mitty-esque type stories that were at once both sad and funny, but let me tell you, always entertaining. So, Whitey, wherever you are, I look up and I tell you I love you, I miss you, we all love you, we all miss you, and for you, my friend, no more demons, for us, no more, yeah, sure. But damn, do we have some memories of this man. So listen, enjoy the music.
share some Whitey stories, real or imagined, but above all, do some laughing. Mr. Glenn would heartily concur, Squire. Your husband, thank you so much, Mr. Gleitsky, Tony Daniels, on bass, Joe Agnello, and the man who helped put this nightmare together, because logistically these things always are, and I think he did a fabulous job on drums, Mr. Dave Reckles.